one each artist, recognition of her work has come in the shape of being elected to a prestigious art society. Liz Watts from Moncton Farley has an exhibition on at the moment in Edinburgh and has now become an associate member of the United Society of Artists, and it's an organisation aimed at helping artists who live outside of London. Well, I'm pleased to say Liz and a couple of her pieces join us this afternoon. Liz, thank you for bringing them in. Very carefully, I'm sure. Wrapped up.
I get probably quite casual with them after.
So, yeah. I'm not in the least bit. So, look, thank you very much for coming in. Now, first of all, let's talk about this art society. So, how big a deal is it to become a member?
To me, it was a very big deal because you have to go through different selection processes to get in. And I was very lucky earlier on this year. I got picked up by an organisation called Creative Coverage, who are a membership organisation who work for artists and galleries, and it was them that first put me in touch with United Society of United Artists, and they proposed submitting to their open exhibition in Cork Street, which I did in London, which I did this summer, and I got pieces into that, which was great for me, because to get your work into Cork Street is just fantastic. And then they said, well, apply for membership. To apply for membership, what you actually have to do, you send CV and all your details. So you have to take four pieces of work down to their council in London, and it's put through a council meeting to decide if they will let you become, to start with, an associate member. And after that,
well, that's scary waiting for
it. It was actually quite worrying, because I got there and I looked at the artwork coming in from other artists, and I thought, I'm way out of my depth here. Because there are some just beautiful pieces. If you go on their website, you'll see the artwork of the people, the candidates who were elected this time. And there's some amazing paintings went through. I think I was the only sculptor on this occasion.
Well, I'm looking at your pieces, I'm thinking, don't do yourself down. These are pretty stunning. Are these the works? Is this some of the works you took?
This is two of the four pieces that I took up.
Okay. What is the benefit of being part of that society?
They will take my work into places where it would be very difficult for me to get it myself. The open exhibition, which anyone can apply to initially, is the one in Cork Street. But this autumn in November, they have a members exhibition at the Bankside Gallery, which is by the Tate on South Bank. And then they do various satellite exhibitions through the year to St Ives and places like that. So you can really take your work out to a new audience.
So there you are in Moncton Farley,
yeah.
But your work will be seen in St Ives, or it will be seen in London.
Yes, because of this organisation. Though each time they do an exhibition, they have very high standards you have to get to. So when they do the members exhibition, I have to submit up to six pieces, and they have to pass the panel. I don't automatically get exhibited with them. And you can't get full membership unless you've been a member for 2 years and got a certain number of pieces through to their exhibitions. So they're not just saying, we want you to be like this to get in. They need you to prove that you can keep a good standard
you
of original and new work,
sure,
over a period of time, and then you can get full membership. So,
well, let's talk about the work. You brought in two pieces. Let's first of all talk about what you have.
This is bronze.
Is bronze?
He's a bronze. He's on my blog, which I put up this morning.
Yeah.
He's called Stagman 2, and it's taken from a life piece.
I miss Stagman 1.
Stagman 1 is on my website.
All right, fair enough.
I miss him too, but it's all gone. He's a bronze, and the first Stagman image I did was very popular, and people said, well, can you do another one? And I said, well, no, because I haven't got a life piece that gives me the feeling for the emotion that I want the piece to have. And I particularly like the model that posed for this, because as you can see, it's a very muscly person, but when he struck up the pose, it's a very modest pose, so it's incongruous with the body image.
Yes, it is, isn't it? Yeah. Because there's almost like a six-pack there.
Yeah, you think he should be there.
He's all proud and kind of showing off, but he's kind of being very modest and put the head, stag's head down and his waist.
The reason I wanted this is because I spent 10 years living in a French deer forest, and when you see images of stags in the UK, it's always this Monarch of the Glen image. But in fact, if they're in a forest in France where they're hunted, and they've got antlers that make them look like a Spanish galleon, they have to get through low trees, what you find is you can get the does to come in close, but the stags hang back. So the stags have got this hugely powerful body image, but actually they're the last ones to come forward. They're always in the trees, always in the shadows, and this piece sort of shows that juxtaposition of the character of the beast and the body of the beast, and that's how a wild stag, when he's being chased by people with guns and dogs, really is.
Well, that beast, and very different. That's that piece. And tell us about these
sort of pottery. This is bronze. This is porcelain. I particularly like porcelain because of this. You can touch this. It's tactile. And as a sculptor, I like... There's nothing like tactile work on the radio, I think.
Wow, yeah.
This is called bluefin tuna netting the futures market, and it's porcelain with platinum. And this is about the value of tuna, which... As the bluefin tuna becomes rarer, it's actually been caught and frozen, because over time, the meat's almost an investment. So you've actually got this terrible situation where it's actually to the advantage to see fewer bluefin tuna in the sea, because the investment you've made in frozen meat is becoming worth more and more, because it's got a fatty belly, which is particularly good for a sushi delicacy.
But this is beautiful because you've got the kind of waves of the sea there, and you've got the netting. It's incredibly delicate. Is it a delicate piece?
It's quite strong when it's done. And what I like about porcelain is, because you fire it high and it vitrifies, the end piece is very strong. But what it means is you actually stress the clay enormously in the process. So you get a certain amount of work which you lose. So there's always a bit of a gamble. But I quite like that. I like the fact that the work sort of takes a bit of a mind of its own. So you go for your chase. I always say to people, I chase an image. So I know where I want you to see. I don't always know how I'm going to get there. These are enormously complicated pieces, which I've developed a technique myself for layering up and building porcelain like this. So you've got this. So although it looks fragile, if I pick this up by the net...
Please don't drop it. Please don't drop it.
You'll see that. And actually, the net is a separate layer of the pot. So everything is integral. The whole thing has to be built quite quickly and dried very quickly. So the final piece is one solid piece. There's nothing... stuck on. It's all within the body of the work.
Well, what we'll do is, I think it's on your blog, but we'll pop those up on our Facebook page if that's all right. I'm always intrigued with artists. They know you're very passionate about the reasons behind what you've done, but then you could tell them, and that's the kind of idea of it.
I always think it's a bit like a sort of surrogate mother, really. You make work that you know you will sell, and then there's other work. I have pieces, say, of my own dog or my own children. Now, those I would never sell, because my relationship with those pieces is entirely different. And also it's the image chasing, because you want to keep telling the stories you want to tell with the images, and that means you have to let the images go and move on to the next thing you want to talk about with the artwork. So you don't want to sit on lots of images that you've sort of said what you had to say about. You want to move on. I've always got more ideas in my head than I have pieces of work. I've always got an in-tray that's overfull with where I would like to take my work next.
How's the exhibition going in Edinburgh, is it?
It went very, very well on the opening night. That was very, very good. And I was a student in Edinburgh, so it was lovely because lots of my old friends turned up, so it had a lovely atmosphere to it. That runs until the end of August.
Assuming not everyone is heading off to Scotland, where can we see your work?
You can see my work in a gallery you may not know about, which is a new gallery at Southwick, near Trowbridge, and it's called the Greenhill Cottage Gallery. And it was opened in June by Martin Slade, and it's full of lovely pieces of work. And he's incredibly friendly, so if you're not a normal gallery person, and you just think, oh, I don't think I'll get to the gallery.
Be a bit intimidating.
No, Martin will make you welcome. He'll make you welcome. And it's sort of out in the middle of the sticks of it in Southwick, but he's very, very friendly, a lovely place to go, and he's got a very nice eye, so you'll find it's full of interesting bits of artwork as well. So.
Well, look, thank you for bringing your very interesting artwork in for us. What about your website, your blog, that we can find out more about you?
My website is www.lizwatts.co.uk, and my blog can be accessed from that, which has some of these images of these two pieces on it.
Brilliant. Well, look, thank you for coming in, and congratulations on becoming the fantastic member of the Art Society. That's brilliant. And we will pop those pictures up on the Facebook page for you to see. They do look absolutely magnificent.
BBC Wiltshire Breakfast.